So yeah, we're recording, and I might do some editing in the beginning and the end, something like that. But maybe I'll start with. So we haven't talked for almost 2 years, and you've gone through a rebrand since then,
Have yes.
and Wisdompreneurs, the Facebook group, for anyone watching and listening to this, if you're not part of Wisdompreneurs, I tell everyone to go join. Everyone who's like-minded, like heart, wants to grow a mindful business. And so that's grown from, I remember when I first joined, I think you were already maybe over 1,000 or something like that. And then now, as of today, it's over 15,000 members. And what's impressive to me is that I think what's wonderful about what you've done is that you've diligently, cultivated that community so that it's not another large Facebook group where people go and just, share links all day long, like, hey, check out my blog post, check out my but it's a group where people feel safe to ask vulnerable questions as they grow their as they work on their business and as they come across challenges. And also when they have successes to share their updates. And so that's what I love. That's why I keep sending people there. I'm like, okay, if you have a question about building a business, go there. I mean, if you haven't asked in Wisdompreneurs, there you should be asking that. So I mean, I have so many questions for you about that. Is I've seen so many other people try to build an online community. I myself have tried as well. And these things have petered out for most online groups I've been part of, and for my own as well. What have and you're I mean, you are showing up just about every day there. And what do you think makes your process different than other groups that seem to peter out?
Some of it, let me just say, George, it's great to hang out with you again. It's really fun. 2 years is too long. Let's not wait 2 years till next time. Some of it is just luck. In terms of, it was a tribe that wanted to find each other. There was a place, there was a gathering space that wanted to happen in this conscious business, conscious entrepreneur conversation. There are great communities of people who are doing that work, but most of them are behind paywalls. And we wanted to make it open source. And I know you're a big fan of like making, creating resources that people can access wherever they are. One of our members, I remember meeting one of our members, he lives in a small village in Pakistan, and he has 2 hours of electricity a day, and they never know quite which 2 hours it's going to be. So we wanted to create a Facebook community that, not Facebook, we didn't originally know where we wanted to do it. We just knew that diversity and inclusion is part of the core values of Wisdompreneurs. And we wanted to find a way, it felt to us that there was a certain level, we were born at Wisdom 2.0, a conference that's had a lot of traction and has gotten some flack for being a privileged-based community.
And just for anybody who happens to be participating in this, Wisdom 2.0, if I can try to describe it, it's a what I saw from it is it's really a corporate event, or it's an event for corporate leaders who want to bring more mindfulness to their business practices. Is that right? How would you would that is that accurate?
It's grown beyond that, but that was certainly the person that Soren, the founder of Wisdom 2.0, is a guy named Soren Gordhammer, who I've been friends with for a long time. And yeah, Soren was thinking about a project manager at Facebook or a coder at Google, not just the upper level executives, but certainly if you work at Google, it's a little bit of a different experience to be in the world than somebody who lives in Pakistan in a village that only gets 2 hours of electricity a day. Soren was not thinking of the person who lives in Pakistan or somebody who lives in Africa or even somebody who's a new solopreneur launching a business or somebody who's moderately successful. He was thinking of the techerati, I've heard it called.
Yeah. Yeah, and it's yeah, like you said, it's grown beyond that. It's seems quite successful. Wisdompreneurs, the group that you founded, came out of, was it a meeting there, like a session?
We'd done a break. When Soren founded Wisdom 2.0, he had these leaders, these particular, it was very much the intersection of wisdom and technology. That's the 2.0 part of the brand.
Yes.
And what he didn't expect is that I used to be, I'm a friend of his, and then I worked for Soren for a while. I was the director of social media. So I took my job to be one part sort of sharing of information, but also one part to be like community manager. Like, who's here? Why are you here? You know, what are you interested in? And then I myself and other people would go around and like, who's at the conference or on, you know, on social media, if we were having a conversation or if there was a holiday party, like just who's in the room. And what we found is that more than half of the people who are coming to Wisdom 2.0 were solopreneurs and small startups, somebody who had a wearable that was using mindfulness to help people with anxiety symptoms, or somebody who's bringing yoga into corporations. Mm. Small organizations or solopreneurs that, you know, wanted to connect and didn't know where else to go. And that was not who was on the main stage. The main stage were the co-founders of Twitter and Eckhart Tolle, beautiful people. But that tribe wanted to connect. And we did a breakout session in February of 2013 called it Wisdompreneurs, and the rest is sort of history. So there are some things we've done to be very intentional about the space and our core values and our promotion policy. There are some things we've done that have worked. But part of it, George, is just having a brand that, and making it open source that people were they were looking to connect, and we just happened to create a space to do it at the right time.
If I could share my perspective on why I think it's grown so well, not only in terms of size, but the depth, is I think that Wisdompreneurs, the word, the name is a great one. So I think that helps people to identify that, oh.
I do branding for a living. It's one of the things I do. So
so that came, yeah. So this is actually, I feel like, has always been one of my weaknesses. I've kind of owned the fact that, you know what? I don't have to be great at everything. You know, it's like, I'm going to let other people be great at branding or refer people to them. And I'll be good at what I'm good at, you know. So Wisdompreneurs, great brand. Secondly, is I think it's great that you started with some in-person connectivity. So there was a feeling of camaraderie there when the group started. And I don't think that's a requirement for starting an effective online group, because I think that, but I do think that there needs to be some initial relationships between the first people there.
Yes.
You know, and even if it's just online friends and then coming together, let's form a group, I'll talk about this thing and see if it grows. But the third thing I would say is your consistency, I've noticed, in showing up in the group. And I know you're gonna be a modest person, so you probably won't say this. So I'm gonna say it for you, is that I think you are so consistent in being there just about every day, and you post things that are interesting conversation starters. You kind of allow people to show up with their opinions, their lessons learned, their kind of vulnerable questions and things like that. So I think that makes it really special. And I think that as a result, people go, oh, I can always go to Wisdompreneurs. There's always some interesting conversation happening there that where people are really sharing of themselves and trying to help each other out.
It's certainly the intent. One of our core values for Wisdompreneurs is community.
Yeah.
So it's not about, again, there are great leaders in the marketing realm. If you want to do video marketing, there are certain people you want to go and you want to check out their system, or you want to do Facebook or LinkedIn or sales funnels. There's so much expertise out there.
Yeah.
We had a different intent. What we were trying to do is create a circle of where the people who are going to look at different pieces of creating a business in the realities of, you know, this kind of thing where I'm sitting in Santa Fe, New Mexico, and you're in the Bay Area, and here we are having a heartfelt conversation. Yeah. It's interesting times we live in.
Yeah.
And how do you create a business that has the kind of depth that you're talking about? We all are going to have different approaches to how we grow our business, what we do. It's a little bit like in the spiritual world, you know, there's a lot of ways to meditate and there's a lot of ways to pray. You know, Rumi said, there's many ways to kneel and kiss the ground. It's one of my favorite lines in all the world of poetry. We wanted to create a place that was bigger than any one system. It's not a Buddhist community. We're not a contemplative Christian tradition or a Native American spirituality, community.
Yeah.
The same with the processes of growing a business. There are many ways to do it on the entrepreneur end of things too. We wanted to create a circle where people who were thinking about depth and thinking about how to create right livelihood and the complexities of a modern conversation and the modern economy could come together and have conversations, right? That was our intent. And in that circle, some people were looking, they were hungry for that circle and didn't know where to go. And then we came along and just said, you know, we're not going to offer you, you'll come to this group and then we'll, you know, buy our Facebook ads program. We don't have a Facebook ads program. Yeah. We don't have anything like it, right?
Yeah.
So that, it was just bringing forth the circle that some people were really hungry for at the right time. And, you know, it's only been 3 years, from zero to 15,000 in 3 years. And it's all been very part-time. Neither myself or anybody else makes the full-time livelihood doing Wisdompreneurs. As a matter of fact, Wisdompreneurs is just barely starting to generate any revenue at all. It's a very small portion of where any of my money comes from. My money comes from doing branding and marketing.
Yeah. That's the labor. It's a labor of love. And I think that is where projects have the most, has the most heart. And I think people feel that. People feel like, I know there's been conversation in Wisdompreneurs about the word funnel, right? Mm. I haven't been privy to all of that, but I actually heard about it from someone else. Mm. When you go to Wisdompreneurs, you're not entering a sales funnel.
Yeah, I mean, to be totally transparent, I do branding and marketing consulting for wisdom entrepreneurs. So it's not like, a mentor of mine talks about enlightened self-interest, right? That's a frame that means something to me. It's not totally, because I also see this, George. I see people who are spiritual entrepreneurs give and burn themselves out.
Yeah, right? Yeah.
One of the fundamental practices that I teach my clients is that marketing is just steady, loving presence in the marketplace. Right? Just go find your, we'll talk about all, you could do it on video, you could do it on Facebook.
Say that again, steady.
Steady, marketing is just steady, loving presence in the marketplace.
Yeah,
that's all you got to do. Okay. You know, we need to figure out your particular way of doing that with depth and integrity where your presence is really felt.
Yeah.
So I'm a solopreneur. You know, I get help occasionally in my business, but basically I'm a solopreneur like you. My website that I make my living from is paulzelizer.com. Yours is georgecow.com, right? We need to be visible in some way, and you're doing this beautiful thing with video, and you're, you know, just talking before we turn the recording on of bringing your podcasting back, and you're writing blog posts. You're really, really good at being visible. Like, hey, you crank out content. Like, I don't know how you do it, George. I'm really interested. How do you crank out so?
My gosh, it's, I mean, just like that same question I was, how do you manage this community? I think that's the key, is that you and I and each person who is out there lovingly building their business has their unique strength.
Yeah.
And we don't all have to be Paul Zelizer or George Cow or any other person that you're learning from, you know.
Yeah.
It's like, and I think you, I mean, especially with branding, I bet you are having this kind of conversation with your clients, is you're helping your part of your job is to observe, I imagine, and to shed light your own insight into, oh, this is what makes you so special.
Yeah.
And this is what it comes so naturally to you that you don't even notice it.
Yeah, exactly.
That is what I think we need to see in each other. So when you ask me, George, how do you create so content? I'm like, Oh, really? Do I?
Oh, dude, you like create like, I don't know, at least my commitment is once a week, and you seem to be doing at least like five.
Yeah, I would say now in the past 3 weeks particularly, it's now, the rhythm is now like five videos a week.
So you're creating five times more content than me. And like my last video, which has done really well, right? But it's work. Like the last video I shot was, I'm crunching the numbers. I got three times more new prospects than when I blog. And I used to do long form blogs, 2,000 words, really, you know.
Wow.
And now it's like, wow, this 2.5 minute video is getting three times. And it didn't take me, some of my blogs would take me 15, 20.
Oh, of course.
Minutes, right.
Yeah. I
really go deep, right?
Yeah.
And I was like, oh my God, that's amazing, right? So, but I shot that 2.5 minute video seven times before I was like, all right, now it's ready, right? Like I have to work content and I'm willing to do it. But like to be in the Facebook community and hold a community of 15,000 people and all of the complexities that sometimes means is actually easier for me than to like write that 2,000 word blog post
totally.
Or shoot the video seven times, right? And, you know, willing to do it. But I get a lot of visibility by being in that role. I get asked to be and speak here and summits this. And it's part of how many people who do approach me to be clients. I'm doing a conversation with a wonderful woman named Jane Morrow, a coach who lives out in Southern California. And she calls it Radical Conversations. And the focus of it's next week, I think. And the focus of our call is dialogue, like really meaningful dialogue, radical conversations. Is that a viable way to do business in this economy, right?
Mm.
And I would say my experience is yes, right? Being really visible as somebody who helps hold a space of dialogue that doesn't have a lot of peers, at least in our sector, means that I get to be really visible without having to churn out video after video after video or blog post after blog post.
Yes.
My visibility is much more than most people who, you know, create content or I only send out a newsletter usually once a month. You know, some people are saying you're supposed to do it five times a week.
Wow.
I can't do that. I'm not aligned with it. I hate it when somebody emails me five times a week, but like, you know, it's expensive to live and I have a kid and we eat organic food and, you know, I don't live extravagantly by any means, but living in the U.S. is expensive.
It is.
Especially where you live. And I live in Santa Fe, New Mexico, a little less, but still not the most affordable place in the world.
Yeah.
So, like, somehow, if you're going to run a viable business, visibility is a key issue, and we all have to find right relationships. This has been a way that makes sense to me.
Yeah.
I have some training around. I used to be a social worker, and I did a bunch of work on the pueblos of northern New Mexico, like Taos Pueblo is the most famous one. And everything there is about community. Everything is about the soul.
Yeah.
So, like, I have spiritual training about the power of a circle and what happens and how hungry most modern humans are for a deep sense of community. And I kind of knew that in myself because, again, I'm so great. I would just happen to be the white guy with a degree when kids were in trouble on the pueblos. And they're like, well, you're not from here, but you need to know a few things because you're going to be working with our kids. So then they download stuff to me, right? And so this being has been blessed with many beautiful experiences, and that informs who I am. And holding circles is, I got some pretty advanced level training that you can't get in grad schools. You can't take a workshop from some of the stuff I got, but it's from people who have been living in one place. It's the oldest, Taos Pueblo is the oldest continually inhabited building in North America. They've been living there for 1,000 years.
Wow.
They've learned a few things about how to do community well, right? Mm. So when it came to how do I want to be visible, I brought some of that into my business because it was something that was gifted to me.
That's amazing. Wow, that's what a rich background and opportunity for you've learned the spirit of community and you're learning to bring, you're practicing to bring that to the online space.
And now we're going back off. Now Wisdompreneurs is starting to get local and start to do some stuff in some really granular ways in different communities around the world, but sync it up through this. A friend of mine, lent me the, what do you call it, the director's cut, the movie Avatar, where they, the, there was, it was a longer version of it, the more fuller version of the movie Avatar. It was like this net, right? So hopefully the intent is that Wisdompreneurs can be this net where people are sharing information and having deep dialogue.
Yes.
And something meaningful happens, and, you know, in Santa Fe, we're going to start doing some really cool local stuff and talking to people in Boulder and Oklahoma City, and how do we sync them up but have a very local experience of meaningful dialogue in circle with our local wisdom entrepreneur friends, and then have it be synced up with what's happening globally.
Totally. Oh, that's beautiful. That's really beautiful. I like this idea of, well, essentially creating content through conversation.
Yeah.
In Wisdompreneurs, it happens through the Facebook comments, right? Someone posts a question, other people chime in with their feedback, their insight, which then other people might reply to, and then the conversation keeps building on each other, on itself. In fact, one of the items on my end of day checklist every day, and people who know me know that I'm like this, I've got like these structures for how I run my day. And my end of day checklist includes a question: did I comment in a group today?
Mm-hmm.
If so, copy that comment and see if it needs to be recorded as a video or something like that.
Nice.
Just as a reminder, because I think some of the most brilliant, I've seen some of the most brilliant ideas, supportive sort of frameworks come out in Facebook comments. And I feel like it's, that should be highlighted. That should be
absolutely taken out
and created. Yes. Like that should be, you know, shouted from the mountaintops almost, some of these things.
Yes.
And then, so I'm imagining, like, as I'm imagining this sort of ideal wisdom business type of world, I'm imagining communities like Wisdompreneurs where people come together and create content and relationships just by the virtue of being supportive presence there. And then I think I'm encouraging people to really to take it to the next step and say, who are you meeting in here that you want to connect with more on a one-to-one basis, just like you and I are?
Yeah.
And schedule that connection, make that happen. And if it feels comfortable, record the conversation.
Yeah.
Even if you do nothing with it, you have an opportunity now to turn that into a video that you can easily upload onto YouTube or Facebook, or take the audio, put that, for those of you who don't know, if you use Zoom, like we are right now, zoom.us, the recording automatically gives you a separation between the video and just the audio itself, which makes it super easy to then create into a podcast. And I'm imagining that as people create more one-to-one connections that come out of come out of meaningful community, the community, of course, is stronger because people really know each other better and they can engage in a more meaningful way. But I'm also seeing this ecosystem, and I'm sure you've seen this probably, this conversation with entrepreneurs, this ecosystem of businesses get formed.
Yep.
So that next time immediately after this conversation, I'm sure if I think of someone who needs branding, you're the first person who's obviously going to come to mind, right? It becomes an ecosystem. And so, you know, earlier on today, I talked with Doug Foresta. He's a podcast specialist. So immediately, if I think of someone who needs podcasting help, so it's like, people, let's connect more one-to-one. I feel like this is something I've been saying to my clients over the years. I say, there is so little one-to-one connection between people online. It genuinely surprises me. Genuinely surprises me, because I've been in this business of marketing coaching for 7 years full time. And I always say, like, I can almost count the few people who have reached out to me for a one-to-one connection in a thoughtful way. I mean, yes, we all get emails every now and then that are just very generic. They haven't researched us at all. They just want to get something out of us.
Yeah.
And the second level up is they research us just a little bit, and they just wanted to speak on a telesummit so that we can promote it to our lists.
Exactly. I get a lot of that.
Right, exactly. It's like,
I don't know how many times.
Right? And I always, now my reply, Paul, you might find this interesting.
I might steal it from you, yes.
No, please. My reply is, I love having conversations, sharing the best knowledge that I can in any setting. My policy, however, is that I have made an agreement with my audience that I will only share content with them that does not require an email opt-in.
Nice.
And so if you are willing for me to share my session with you on your telesummit freely, like on a YouTube video or embedded on my site where people don't have to opt in, then I will be happy to share it. Mm-hmm. And my other policy is that I will share it on social media for sure, but I may or may not share it through my email.
Nice.
Depends.
You know, you're a disruptor, George. You're totally disrupting this whole
and not surprisingly, 9 out of 10 say, oh, you know, looks like you're not the best fit.
Thanks, but no thanks, right?
But there is like that 1 out of 10 that creates this beautiful conversation, which, oftentimes become friends with them and this ecosystem starts to grow. Yeah. And so I really believe that, I think we should be encouraging everyone just to, let's create an ecosystem so that just like with the Pueblo, it's like, you don't have to work alone anymore. There is, and I know there's been a conversation with entrepreneurs where about entrepreneurship and depression.
Yeah.
And it's like, where does that come from? Well, I believe it comes a lot because we have lost community and we feel like we are alone in the dark, you know?
Yeah, George.
We don't have the wisdom and insight that we need, and we don't have the friendships and the colleagueship that makes us feel that no, we're not going to be out on the streets. These people will help us. These people will come to our aid.
Absolutely. Oh gosh, George, there's so much you just said.
And that's what you're doing. That's what Wisdompreneurs is becoming.
We're growing into it. You know, I want to be really fair. Online, we've done great. It's been bumpy. You know, it's been awkward right now. My co-founder is going through some health challenges. So took two people who were already stretched and busy and turned it into one, and we dropped some balls. So anyway, I want to be really transparent that it hasn't been like this amazing, easy thing every step.
Yeah.
I want to say that at first. But there's a couple things I want to say also. One is, it's not a formula or a signature system, but I do use a map with my clients.
Mm.
I think you might appreciate it, what you were saying earlier. The map that I use with my clients is brand, content, network.
Right?
Brand, content, network. Yeah. It's really hard to have meaningful conversations online or, you know, in one-to-many, like your videos going out. If you don't, you know, if one day you're doing it on some healing system like Reiki, and the next you're doing something on growing your business, and the next you're doing it on, you know, healthy eating, and the next you're doing it on an energy healing technique, and you're doing it on how you should get out in nature because that has been shown to reduce depression, which it has, and then the next you're doing it on parenting, it's really confusing. And over time, people just like, well, George seems like a nice guy, but I'm not going to hire him because I'm going to go over here and talk to so-and-so who's, you know, or vice versa. Paul's a scattered guy. George is like really crisp and really focused in what he's doing. So that's the brand part. Who are you? Not just in terms of certainly in terms of the focus of what you're sharing, but also the feeling tone. Part of my brand is aliveness and fun, right?
Mm.
Like sometimes spirituality conversations, and my tagline says wisdom-based business solutions. Sometimes the wisdom world gets a little serious for my person.
Yeah.
And that doesn't always mean it's like, ha, 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 like hilarious, but a sense of like that sparkle in the eyes of somebody who's been practicing a long time and has that sort of like, you know, we're pretty blessed to be alive. It's pretty much, it's such an honor to be on planet Earth and to be a human. The Buddhists say, who believe in reincarnation, they say it's more likely that a turtle, if you threw a small ring into the ocean, that a turtle would accidentally pop its head through that one ring
than it is in the entire ocean.
That it is to be born a human being.
Wow.
That's the kind of reverence in one tradition. Like, whatever your friend, there's lots of other examples of that, but that one's so pointy. You just take a little ring, throw it in the ocean, and it totally pops. That's how blessed we are to be humans.
Yeah.
I want to bring a certain like kind of aliveness to the conversation.
Yeah.
So there's that feeling. And then when you have content like what you do, people can, when they go to your site, they can read your blog. You don't have to like say, oh, I'm this like amazing business coach, I'm the latest, hottest, cool. You let your work speak for itself. But if you have no work out there, then you're at a disadvantage. So start getting good content. Then you can do one-on-one networking, right? Or in groups. But if I'm with you. I think networking is hugely underappreciated. And I'm blessed because I'm Wisdompreneurs co-founder, people come to me. And, you know, I do reach out when I can, but like these beautiful and amazing opportunities sort of fall in my lap without me having to do a lot of work. Usually, like somebody just emailed me before this, he's got something he's launching, and I saw the overlap with both my own personal brand and also with Wisdompreneurs. So we're going to get on the phone a little later, actually, when we hang out and talk about what he's got going. He's a great guy. He's got a six-figure business. But like, that's not what it's about. There's just deep resonance. But it's with somebody who has real strong business acumen. And that's a beautiful combination. I really like that combo. And it happens a lot. Again, for me, I would say, because I have a brand that people understand, Wisdom-Based Business Solution, co-founder of Wisdompreneurs, like people kind of have a sense of what I'm about. They know pretty quickly, I don't need to talk to that guy. I'm not interested. Or, I'd like to, who is this guy? I mean, there might be some overlap here. Then we get on and we do this, and all kinds of amazing things happen. And I don't have a very big email list. I don't really, if I never sent an email again, my client flow probably wouldn't change that much, right? It's built on that awareness, right? Have a really good brand, have a really good plan for that story to go out into the world through your content. Mm-hmm. And then you network, and it just, you don't have to work that hard.
Yeah.
More fun for me to do this than write, you know, really complicated.
Totally.
Search engine optimized blog post with 2,000 words and links and way more fun, right?
Totally. Yeah, absolutely. I love the simplicity of that map. Actually, I have a quite similar map. It's interesting. We kind of use different words. I talk about optimizing your offering, and then I talk about content, and I talk about enrollment, and then joyful productivity, kind of like this cycle. But the map is similar because we're looking at reality here,
you know, right?
Businesses are created. So the thing about content that you said is interesting is that, yes, we don't have to do what the internet marketers are teaching us if it doesn't float our boat. You know, it's like we each need to find natural ways of creating content that is aligned with our brand and that is joyful. And if we are willing to be creative, there are plenty of ways to discover that. Yeah. And so, like, I mean, I think, like I said, you know, this one-to-one connection, if you're willing to record it, rich content can come out of it. And even if you don't record it, it's like if you're talking with someone one-to-one, it's good that afterwards to take some notes to say, what came out of that conversation that I'd like to share in my next writing or in my next video or my next something. And I always tell my clients to say, listen, after you meet with clients, if you can, if you have 2 minutes, take a pause and just do a little bit of writing or even if you want to record it on your phone or something.
Yeah.
What was the insight, right? Yeah. What was the insight that came out of that could bless others? Like them.
Absolutely. I want to go back to what you were saying. There's that, there's the one-on-one, and then also going back to the conversations on social media. So a really great example of that, the best post I've seen in the past week or so, Tia Silvestre at Story Bistro wrote an incredible post. I thought it was very well done, which was about I don't remember the title, but I have to look it up.
Was it a post in Wisdompreneurs?
She started the conversation. She went to her own network, and she also came to Wisdompreneurs saying, talk to me about the intersection of chronic illness and entrepreneurship, because I'm noticing a significant number of people growing over. She'd been in business a while. I don't remember how long Tia has been in business, but a while, 10, 12, 15 years, something like that. And she does story-based marketing consulting, does a great job, right? But she's noticing that an increasing number of people in her, both her clients but also her professional network, have some sort of chronic illness.
Yeah.
Myalgia, chronic fatigue, allergies, cancer, you name it, right? Mm. And a bunch of people are turning to entrepreneurship, some consciously because they just don't have the energy. If you got chronic fatigue, it's really hard to work at a, you know, really fast-paced corporate environment, right? There's a mismatch.
Very interesting, yeah.
Or people are just crashing and burning. They've been trying to work in that environment and something happens health-wise where their body or their being says, nope, you're not going to do this anymore. You literally cannot put on your suit and go work 80-hour work weeks. It'll never happen. Your body says no in a variety of ways, right?
Yes.
But you're a human being. You still need to eat. You still need to have a roof over your head. I live in Santa Fe. It gets really cold here in the winter. You need to live somewhere, right? Either that or you, like, you know, drive away, or, like, you know, you're being on the street here in the winter is not the same as being on the street in San. Not that it's fun to be on the street in San Francisco in January, but here it's life-threatening. Right.
Wow.
You have to have a house. You have to have a livelihood, right? Mm-hmm. What do you do when your body is not, just literally can't go into the corporate or organizational environments, the structures that we have? More and more people with that scenario turn into entrepreneurship. And she wrote a post interviewing, I don't know, a good 12 or 15 different people, getting quotes from them. That, you know, this one has this illness, and here's how they work it in. How do they, you have to think about pacing. You have to think, anyway, she did a gorgeous job. And that was just a beautiful example of somebody who, the conversation in Wisdompreneurs and one of the groups, everybody was like, that is an amazing conversation. You should write a post. I was one of the people cheering her on. Tia, write this. That is such an important post for our time. And she did. Yeah. And it's a great post, partially because she's kind of framing it, but she took that community approach.
Yeah.
Social media allows, and she crowdsourced it, and she got more than one person's story. So it allows you to see the wider pick, because she's, you know, if you're new to that situation, you're somebody who's got an illness and you're thinking of entrepreneurship, but you don't know a lot of entrepreneurs who are dealing with this. Tia just, like, let you kind of, she pulled back the curtain and kind of, like, here's the reality. A whole bunch of people really lived this and thought about this,
yeah,
talking to each other, and she wove it together.
Wow.
In a beautiful way. That kind of content, not surprisingly, went totally viral through social media. A lot of people shared it, including me, because it was a great post.
Yes.
It's a really important thing for our time. It wasn't coming from her ego. You could just feel her desire to be of service in that
post.
Not that's the only, Tia's she's a very service-oriented person, but this, you could, there was a different, she took it to a whole new level of being service to a whole sort of generation of humans who are alive right now, having an experience that's not easy to make sense of. And she said, let me show you how some other people who are smart and have thought about this, how they're navigating this water.
Yes.
And gave some beautiful tips. And yeah, it went totally viral. So it's great for her business.
Yes.
And yet she's providing a service for people who are in a really challenging circumstances. That's the best use of these kinds of communities that I can ever imagine, Jordan.
Yeah. Oh, what a great example. Yes. She is basically observed, and that's, like, I think that's key, observed what people are struggling with. She noticed a pattern of struggle among different people. And then she says, how can I help? And how can I then, because everybody has some way for them to cope with their own struggle. And others can learn from that. And so she curated. And so I think in this age, each of us can really benefit others by curating the wisdom of our own network.
Absolutely. I use you all the time with my clients, right? With my clients, you say, oh, but I don't want to, like, do summits. And we talked earlier about your, like, I don't want to, like, do the, like, just blind, you know, incorporate the single bottom line metric is usually profit, right? Short-term profit.
Yeah.
In entrepreneurs, sometimes to me, it feels like the single, people are tracking their profits, but to me, even more than that, the metric that I think is easy to get really out of balance around is the size of your email list, right? That's sort of the, if they're going to make a single bottom line metric.
Oh my gosh.
The online marketing space, it's the size of your email list, right?
Yeah.
And I have clients who just single bottom line just doesn't feel good, right? And like I said, I don't have a huge email list. And
it's the opposite of holistic, right? The single myopic focus on one number.
Exactly. Monolithic ways of doing business don't feel so. They're like, but Paul, am I going to be broken on the street if I don't? And I'm like, well, let me tell you. I'll tell you the size of my email list. I'll tell you. There's this guy George. He's made a big shift, and we've talked before. So I remember when you were doing more of that, and now.
Did I tell you that I removed, like 90% of my email list?
No, you didn't tell me that.
Okay,
right. I didn't know that. It felt like you got out of you got out of integrity, out of imbalance, out of balance at least.
Yeah.
That conversation around some of this single bottom line email focus, and you're like, I'm not doing that anymore.
No, it's so a year ago. So after we had this conversation 2 years ago, a year ago, I made this radical choice to prune 90% of my email list. Now I have to say that what I did was I downloaded those email addresses. I put them in a Google Drive spreadsheet just in case I realized I made some crazy mistake, but I haven't actually looked back.
Okay.
I actually removed the people from my email list who had not clicked on links or hadn't opened the email. I think my criteria was if they haven't opened my, if they haven't opened my email in the last 6 months or clicked on a link, I guess that was it. In the last 6 months, then I didn't, the way I said is I no longer want to burden their email inbox with my email, because I know how it feels to keep getting these emails. And so I removed them, and several benefits came out of that. One benefit was I saved over $100 a month from my email list provider,
nice. Right?
Because it's the larger the list, generally the more you have to pay.
The more you pay, sure.
And even though the list people are not even reading your stuff, you're still paying to clutter up their inbox, right? Or I was. And so the other benefit of it was that I kind of felt like, wow, now my number is manageable enough where I feel like I really want to serve these people. Like, these are the people who are actually reading my stuff. Not that the other people aren't important, they're important, but maybe they will prefer to read my stuff on social media.
Yeah.
Maybe they prefer to hear about me from other people, but for some reason that my emails to them were not the right channel to continue that interaction. So these people now, obviously my open rates have grown a lot.
I bet they're quite a bit higher.
And then my click rates, and the benefit from that is of course the deliverability of the email. More people are actually getting my emails now rather than going to spam or some other folder. And I may also make this radical choice where I said I'm going to separate out my content list from my launch list. Meaning I used to put them in one where, that's the general idea, right? You have one email list. Sometimes you send content. Sometimes you send your launch, by launches, meaning, oh, I'm ready to take on more clients, or I have this group program now.
Sure.
And I decided to separate that. And I said, and I actually gave people a choice. Say, all right, now this is just a content list. Now the one that you're on, I'm just going to send you free content. There's no opt-in, just my best stuff. If you want to also be notified when I'm open to clients or launch a group program, you need to also take action to join this other list.
Wow.
Right? It's like, and then the third radical thing I did was I made it hard, relatively speaking, to join my list, which is counterintuitive. But there's something about people seeking something out that they want. And that energy that they invest in seeking it out makes it more valuable and more meaningful for them.
Yeah.
And so it's not like it's impossible to find where to join my newsletter, but it's no longer either a pop-up or it's no longer even above the fold on the homepage. You now have to actually look in the navigation, or they have to go to the footer to then click on the link. And then they get to a certain place where it says, all right, you can either join my content list or my launch list, or both, I guess.
Nice.
So it's this kind of, and I haven't looked back, and I've been so grateful to know that I'm now shepherding this community. You know, so, you know, and I'll have to say, yes, it's still early days, I think, for me. So I'm still learning how to, I mean, for sure now my open rates are pretty steady now, pretty high and pretty steady. My click rates are the same. Now I'm, of course, but my launch list is way smaller because I gave them that choice. And so it is more challenging when I want to announce a service or product. It's not getting as many, you know, views as it used to, but I know that for the people but nobody is unsubscribing from my launch list.
Right.
You know, like, it's very interesting. Like, when I do send them something, they actually want to see it.
Exactly. That's great, George. Yeah. You're really...
So I'm experimenting.
And I would love to hear, there's an experiment you're doing about Patreon that I'm really curious. That's another experiment that I'm like, tell me about that. That's really cool.
So Patreon is a platform where content creators can get the financial support of their audience, either per thing they create, like per video they create. Audiences can pledge to say, listen, I love your videos, man. Every time you make a video or every time you write a blog post, I'm gonna give you $2. Mm-hmm. You know, just because I love your stuff and it's really worth at least that much to me. So that's one way that people support others on Patreon. The other way is through a monthly pledge to say, all right, Paul, I just love your overall work, your Wisdompreneurs. In fact, I was gonna put in that thread, Paul, where's your Patreon? You know,
well, that, we're gonna start one with Wisdompreneurs. That's I don't know that I'm gonna do one personally, but for Wisdompreneurs to start to have some resources,
yes,
so can do a little more building out and shepherding of the community. There's a bit of resources there.
Oh, so, I'm absolutely going to be one of the supporters there.
Oh,
but the idea is a realignment with this beautiful spiritual tradition of, I think it's pronounced Dana.
Dana, right? The Buddhist tradition, yeah.
Yeah, this, like, this idea of generosity. I mean, in the Christian tradition, it'd be charity.
Yes.
You know, but it's in every spiritual tradition, there's this idea that if your heart is overflowing for a particular teacher, for a particular organization, let your heart overflow also in your material support.
Yes. A great example of somebody who does this really well, if somebody wants a modern reference of this, one of my favorite meditation teachers is a woman named Tara Brach.
Yes.
Yeah, Tara is amazing. She brings in neuroscience and very deep understanding of mindfulness and the science of it, plus just such a heartful person, and she is a great storyteller. So she and other people in the, particularly the insight meditation tradition, Jack Kornfield and others, they give their teachings away through a collective site called Dharma Seed. But Tara, at the beginning and the end, in a very, very thoughtful way, does a little pitch, you know, these teachings and meditations are freely given. I'm trying to remember, I've listened to a lot of them. And, you know, if you appreciate if you like what you're hearing here, really appreciate your support, either in the form of joining my email list, coming to a workshop, or she has a donation button on her site, which is called tarabrock.com. So here's somebody coming from a tradition, using online, I don't know how many downloads Tara Brach has got. You know, she's a very well-known teacher, huge presence on social media. And she does, does quite well, her workshops and stuff, that she uses this Dana to allow and uses technology in this very generous way. There's no pop-up on dharmaseed.com saying, please give us money or please sign up for it. It's just free. Yes. But then when you click on it and you start listening, she says, you know, hey, just know that this is an opportunity. And I think that's there's an experiment happening, and that there's sort of a maturing, like the people who are early to market with online marketing techniques came from mostly a pretty traditional marketing background. The more the better, more money, more numbers, more
subscribers. And short term,
Short term, single bottom line type metrics is the tradition. And that's how business is mostly on planet Earth. It's changing, but they just brought that training with them. It feels to me like now there's people who have, I have many more decades. Even though I've been doing my business now for almost 10 years, I have many more decades in the meditation and spiritual realm. I started when I was 17, than I do in the marketing. So I'm a wisdompreneur, but I come more from the wisdom tradition. It's only recently that relatively in the span of a human life that I came to the business world. And I think there's more people like that, that are coming from a place of, spiritual tradition or values or whatever you want to call that, who want to use technology. I mean, we wouldn't know each other if technology didn't exist, right? So it's a beautiful thing, and I'm so grateful for it. And the right use of it and how to balance the teachings that I've gotten from so many wisdom teachers, including Native people here in northern New Mexico. You know, single bottom line, if you're a culture that has lived in the same place for 1,000 years and you look, there's a saying at Taos Pueblo that somebody is a younger brother, a younger sister, when we're acting in an immature way. We're still connected, but you're a younger brother, like somebody might say that to you. You would say, oh, I'm so upset about what Susie over there is doing. She's hurting people and herself and her neighbors. And an elder would say, George, yeah, I really appreciate your concern. Susie is a younger sister. Just love her and treat her like a younger sister. She's in an immature place as a human being, and that just happens, right? It takes time for humans to mature. Yeah. And then they'll get mad. They don't ignore it. They have mechanisms if somebody's hurting others to eventually step in. Mm. They have a frame of like the person deserves care and love, but also there are more and less mature ways to be on planet Earth. And I think the uses of online technologies, a lot of us have been younger brothers and younger sisters, right?
Absolutely.
To me, like, there's an experiment going on. What are the more mature uses of these technologies? And I'm so grateful, so excited about that. And I see you really in that, being a thought leader in that conversation.
Yeah, thank you, man. Thank you. Just a quick time check. Are you?
I got about 5 minutes and I got another appointment. Yeah.
Okay. One last thing I want to mention to bring into the conversation is this idea. I was just listening to a podcast today from the Good Life Project, which is a beautiful podcast.
Yeah.
And they were talking about this idea of holding loosely the things. And I feel like that's kind of what I've been called to learn over the past 3 years, is to not be fixated on must grow my email list, must make them get my emails all the time, must, it's just this idea now of like transforming that, say, oh, let me see what I can do if I just let go. My content is now all free. So what if I just let go and then not be as concerned about what comes back right away, knowing that the reality, I believe, of the life, the metaphysical reality, is that you and I are going to be profoundly taken care of. We are profoundly taken care of.
I'm so blessed, George. I'm so blessed. But again, I don't drive a sports car, I don't drive a Lamborghini, I don't make that kind of, but I live in a beautiful place and I have a four-wheel drive car that'll get me into the mountains to do the skiing and the snowshoeing and the hiking that me and my tribe do. And, we eat mostly organic food and, have a beautiful place to live. And I have community and I have time to spend with that community. And that, a client recently, one of my newest clients in one of my groups, we were having a conversation. She asked me really pointedly, how much do I make? And I said, that's great, I'll tell you. And I told her. And I said, but please keep in mind that I work about 30, 32 hours a week to achieve that income. And I'm not working, it's part of my I have gotten out of balance in terms of work with Wisdompreneurs, trying to scale, trying to stay up with some of that. So I've worked more than 30, 32 hours, but my pay, I can support a child, live in a beautiful place, eat organic food, have nice clothes, you know, travel, send my daughter to volleyball camp, put braces on her teeth, you know, health insurance for 30, 32. Most of the world would really, that's, I mean, like, talk about a beautiful life, George, right? Yeah. Like to live well on that kind of lifestyle, that feels good to me. And I'm okay. That's enough, right? I really am at a place. I know what enough is. Yes. And more comes along, I put it into Wisdompreneur, you know, whatever. Yeah. Like, yes. You know, I know I have some ideas of where to put extra, but that sense of enoughness feels like part of the maturing. And I see you, it's a pretty radical experiment with the Patreon. Like, you're going to put your income out there for everyone to see to make that enoughness conversation visible. And I really honor you for that.
Thank you. I am always seeing how can I experiment in a way that can teach something to others to see if they want to join in. But I want to respect your time. I know you got another call.
I do.
Thank you.
This is
wonderful.
Thank you.
Obviously, time continued.
Yeah.
And always let me know how I can help.
Thanks, George. I really appreciate it. I love what you're up to. And thanks for your time.
Yeah, absolutely, man.
All right. You take care.
You too. Bye.